Well, we're at NASA, we're very excited that President Trump announced in the last year that he wants us to go back to the moon, and he'd like to have us back on the moon by 2024. And the other thing that's very exciting, on the Apollo 11 anniversary, Vice President Pence announced that the next person when we go back to the moon will be a female to step, the first one to step on the moon. So we're all very excited about that. But what NASA is planning on doing now is going back to the moon using the Orion spacecraft, which is what the last program that I was working on before I retired in April of 2017. The Orion capsule is very similar to the Apollo capsule, only it's quite a bit bigger. And then we're building the a facility called Gateway, which is kind of like a small space station, so the Orion could dock to it, and then from there we would have a lander that would go to the moon. And what I think and what I hope is going to happen is that we're going to build a base on the moon very similar to what we have in Antarctica now, an international base for research and for science and to learn the techniques we're going to need for our ultimate goal, because our ultimate goal is to go to Mars. But it's a lot easier to develop that technology when you're only 3 or 4 days from home rather than several months from home. And so that's basically the Artemis program. And we're still doing a lot of discussions and design work, but it's well underway. Gateway, which is the sort of mini space station, if you will, that's going to be used as the platform to then go to the moon, is being worked on right now. Orion vehicle is being worked on, and we'll be having a test flight sometime next year. So it's a really exciting time for NASA. Next year is going to be a big year. You know, that's sometimes a hard question to answer because there's so many other things going on in, around the world, the United States, so many important things that you need to spend money on. But I kind of, the analogy I make is to your family. You know, you need to spend the money that you need to live on a daily basis, but you also have to look to your future. You have to have some money for retirement and for other things, even though you need money right now. And that's how I view spending money on the space station, on the space program. It's you're investing in your future. And the amount of money on a percentage basis, certainly in the United States, and I can't speak to all the other countries, but I'm sure it's a very small amount of money out of the U.S. budget that goes to the space program. And the returns that you get from that in terms of all the technology that you develop, there's just so many different things that have come as a result of the space program, all the miniaturization of computers, and there's just so many things that come when you're pushing your technology. For example, to go to Mars, there's a lot of new technology we're going to have to develop, and I'm sure the things we come up with will have benefits here on Earth. But I always feel like I'm being a bit of a salesman when I say that, but it's true. But the thing I really think is important is mankind's spirit needs to explore. And it's an uplifting thing to explore new worlds and to explore new places. From the very beginning, from the origins of life to when mankind spread out to the days of Columbus, Magellan, to in America, going from the east out to the west. It's just the human nature to explore. And that's what I think is the really important part of it. And the other part that I think is very important, and I learned that when I was chief of the space station branch in the astronaut office, was learning to work with our international partners. It was a real learning experience when we first started to have our partnership with the Russian colleagues. And of course, the US had been going into space for a long time, and so had the Russians. And we each thought we knew the best way to do things. And learning to compromise and work together. And here we were, you know, we weren't that far out from being Cold War adversaries when we started our partnership for the space station. And now, it almost doesn't matter what's happening at the higher level between the presidents and the two countries. On a working level from the space program, we get along. We're friends with people around the world, and we are all excited about each other's success. And each partner, ESA, Japan, Canada, Russia, all bring a slightly different perspective. And that's what I think is the most amazing part of the space program. It's the one thing in the world that brings everybody together. And it's something, it's a common goal. And who knows in the future? I mean, the theory is that the dinosaurs disappeared because of an asteroid hitting the Earth. And, you know, that's certainly a probability for something to happen. And we really need to have our species, if we want to survive, eventually go out into the solar system in the universe. And these are just the beginning steps. So although it sounds like a lot of money, it really isn't a lot of money, and it's an investment in your future. And finally, the one other aspect is, I talk to a lot of students and young people from elementary school all the way up to university. And the one thing that really excites them is the space program, science, STEM program. And we need that. We need people who want to go into those areas. And so the space program has always been a platform that really, I think, excites the imagination of young people. It certainly did for me. That's why I'm doing what I'm doing. So I think there's a lot. It's a very small investment for a major return on our investment. So that's about the best I can do. Well, first of all, my daughter says I owe it all to her that I'm the first mom in space, so as daughters will do. You know, I always knew that I wanted a career, and I always knew that I wanted a family. So there was never, in fact, when I interviewed with the astronaut selection board, as we were coming towards the end of the interview, and I said, oh, and by the way, just so you should know, if it affects your decision, I do want to have a family. And you know, nowadays it's illegal in the United States to ask that question, whether, you know, so, but it was very important to me. I didn't plan it to be exactly the way it happened. I was assigned to my flight 2 weeks before I delivered my daughter. I had her on a Friday morning, and I was back at the 8 o'clock meeting on Monday morning. Because I wanted to make a statement. I wanted to say, you know, I know I've just become a new mom, but I'm here and I'm not going anywhere. And I've made this commitment and it means a lot to me. I'm not saying it was easy. It was difficult. It was really hard to leave her not knowing 100% that you're going to come back. But it's really not that different from many other young parents today, male and female. You know, so many folks in the military now, young women and men, you know, are being deployed for a year at a time, and they're away from their family. So there's not really an easy answer. Even today, with all of our technology and everything, it's still a very hard, very personal decision. And I was very lucky that I had a very wonderful lady who took care of Kristen until she went to school, and my mom came the last 6 weeks, which really helped a lot. It just totally, you know, took my mind off of that Kristen was being well taken care of. But there's no easy answers, you know. But the one thing my daughter has said, which makes me very proud, is she said, when my daughter's in broadcast journalism working for Fox News, and when she's asked questions, she said it never even occurred to her that she couldn't have a demanding career and have a family because my mom did it. And so, and I told her when she travels a lot, I said, do not feel guilty. You know, you have a right to be happy as well and to lead a fulfilling life. And if your goal is to do something demanding, well, you just figure out a way to make it work. I think there's lots of different people and everybody has different needs. I did take a 7-year leave of absence after my second daughter was born because I really felt that I needed to be home with both of them. And then after that 7 years, I came back to NASA. And I'll have to say that was the hardest thing I've ever done, coming back after being away for 7 years. But I think I brought a perspective back to the astronaut office because I was the only person left who had been there went before the shuttle flew. And now we were working on the space station, and a lot of the people that were in the office then were used to the program running very smoothly by that time. At the beginning of a program, it's not like that. There's a lot of things you're learning. The training isn't in good condition. The procedures are immature. And so having me there, having seen that already at the beginning of the shuttle program, I think was beneficial to the office. So I think it was a win-win situation for me and for the astronaut office. But there's no easy answers for how to juggle having a family, and every situation is different. You know, if you have a child that's not healthy, for example, or has had a problem, thankfully Kristen was well, and you know, that adds another complexity. So every situation is different, but I also feel that if you are happy with your life and what you're doing, you're a better parent. And so I feel very blessed that, you know, that year that I was training for my flight, I was doing the two things I love most in the world, you know, being a mom and being an astronaut.